Welcome back. This is Knack, and I've got your next tutorial coming at you. We're going to work on applying a handle and a bolster to this blank right here. So I put these two steps together. I know you could probably break them up, but in my opinion, the steps are so closely related that it's important to kind of do both of them together. So it may make a slightly longer video than, you know, if I split it up, but it is what it is. We're going to do some fun things with this particular handle as well. Here's the plan for that. We're going to do a small inlay, and I'm actually going to be using a concho that I got from Tandy Leather Factory. You can see this little skull, maybe. Might be a little blurry. But we're actually going to inlay it into the wood section of the handle. We're going to be putting on a stainless steel bolster. And with two pins, we're going to pin the bolsters. It's going to be kind of fun, and I'm going to show you the methods for or the method that I've come up with for doing inlay, and it works not only for things like this, like a piece of metal into the wood, but it actually will work if you want to do real marquetry inlays, so wood in wood, things like that. But we've got work to do, so let's get started. The first step we're going to be moving into is cutting out the bolsters. All right, don't enjoy that music too much. We've got serious work to do. So I want to mention that this is not the best way to be cutting metal. It's just the way that I kind of have to do it. I don't have all the tools that I'd like. Like metal cutting bandsaws and things like that would be quite useful, but I don't have one, so I use basically a chop saw blade on a grinder. Quite dangerous indeed, folks. Don't do it if you don't have to. And if you are going to do it, make sure you've got a very steady hand, because if you wrench it, across the cross section of that blade, you can break it and have pieces flying up at your face and things like that. So be very, very careful, but it does work, as you can see here, and it's actually quite efficient. But yeah, cutting out the bolsters, we've got, it's kind of a T-shape, as you might have noticed already, and we're going to drill the holes in it. Well, first I'm going to shape it a little bit here on the sander. The big belt sander. We're going to get them pretty close to the final shape on this sander, but it's more of a rough cut here still. And then we're going to drill holes in the two pieces of the bolsters and pin them together. And I know that sounds a little strange because a lot of the times pinning is kind of a permanent deal. But what I'm going to do is just sand the edges of the pins a little bit so that the pins will slip out, and we won't use the same pins when we do pin these bolsters to the blade for permanence. We'll use full diameter pins instead of something that's been sanded down. So, but as you can see, we're just getting these pieces shaped up, and then I'll start drilling the holes and show you how I work them together. That way they are the exact same shape and the holes will be in the exact same spot on either side. So it's kind of fun to do it that way. I know you can do it other ways, and some people are really good at working them completely separately before they put them on the knife, and more power to you, man, but that is difficult to say the least. But I think I've got a good explanation for what's going on for now, so I'm going to give that song back to you for just a bit, and I'll be back with some more commentary in a moment. We'll be right back. Before I let you finish that song, I just want to mention that it might be a little hard to tell, but the bolsters are actually pinned together with those two pins right now. So I am already working them together, making sure that all the edges are perfectly straight and it'll be perfectly symmetrical on either side. So it's important to go ahead and do that, especially if you're going to take the time to pin them together this way. Go ahead and make sure those suckers are perfect. That will make your life a lot easier and a little bit simpler as you move forward. I'll put that song back on. We should be able to finish it before some more important commentary is coming up. And I'll meet you back then in just a second. All right, well, we've got it sanded up super fine, that one side there, which is the side pointing towards the blade. I went up to 9,000 grit. I used slack sanders, you might have noticed, and that gives it a kind of a pleasant curve. That's a standard way to do that. You kind of want those bolsters to be a little bit curved. If they're too straight, sometimes it makes it look strange for certain blade shapes and things like that. But now we buff it up. You saw there I used black and green. And now I'm using pink, and pink obviously does not abrade. It just cleans it up. Okay, just a real quick point of view. We've got these bolsters made up. You can see they're going to look fairly nice on there. We just make sure that the parts that we can't sand and buff after they're put on, it's taken care of beforehand. You can finish them further if you like. I like doing it this way, finishing the rest of it later after it's attached. But we're not going to attach it right now. We'll go ahead and drill the holes next. But I don't want to attach them until I've got my wood scales set up. So we'll get to that right after we drill the holes for these bolsters on the tongue of the blade itself. And then we'll get into the wood and the inlay stuff, so that's gonna be fun. Be right back. All right, well, it's coming along nicely. Now, I'm just using those pins I told you about, the thin ones, so that we can still take this out while we get the wood ready, wood scales ready, but looks pretty good.
that bolster is going to be kind of nice. So now notice that it's a little bit thinner on this side than it is on this side. It's like a little thicker over here. I did that on purpose because I want this to actually be centered down the with the blade, if that makes sense, instead of on the handle, because the handle is actually what's the best way to say it, is the handle is on the top side of the blade, but I wanted that little centerpiece to be centered on with the center of the blade. So I think that's going to look pretty good. But we need to pick out some wood. I was thinking black at first, some like African black wood or black ebony or something like that. But I don't know, I feel like maybe a little bit more brown, something that's going to help accentuate the brass, should be a little bit nice. So let's go take a look and see what we've got here. That would be too light. This is Asian satin wood. It's got wax on it right now, so it doesn't, it looks a lot darker than it is. It's actually quite light color. So bloodwood would be kind of nice, but I think that would make the brass look a little strange. I think what we'll do is, there's that kingwood. Yeah, there it is right here. Let's do this. We'll get some kingwood. It's got some of those, let's see, what would you call it, like caramel tones and some oranges in there. That'll bring out the brass a little bit and make it not look so strange. And then it still has some nice darkness to it that's going to allow the silver color of that skull and the bolster to kind of pop a little bit. So good contrast. That's pretty wood too. This will be nice. Okay. Yeah, let's do that.
Okay, sort of a lot going on here. Basically what I'm doing right now is setting up the scales to fit around that bolster. And you can see that I'm using the actual bolster to trace it, which obviously makes some sense. But instead of tracing it with a pencil first, I like tracing it with an X-Acto knife first. That way when I cut it, there's an actual groove where it is. And so I go right up next to the groove when I cut it. And it's actually really helpful to have the groove there. Now I mark it with pencil, as you saw too, and so that helps me see the mark a lot better as well. But before we get to that, we're also going to cut out these little strips of really thin brass sheet, and it's going to go between the bolster and the handle. Like I said, we're going to do some kind of fun things and new things. This is something I've never tried before. I take that back. I have tried it before. What's different about this time is it's going to curve around that T shape instead of being like a straight line. Because I have put that like a little spacer between, parts of sections of a handle before. I've never, however, curved it around something. And that's going to be a little bit different. So we'll see how this works out. We're going to cut these grooves out where the bolster slips into on the scroll saw. It's a little bit easier to get that. And then I'll try and clean it up on the sander. You want to make sure if you use a sander, though, don't use a slack sander when you're cutting pieces that are supposed to be perfectly straight, because they will always bow on a slack sander. Always, always, always. The edges always sand down faster, so that's always a good thing to remember. But yeah, you can see it's cutting out fairly well. The scroll saw I've got is not, it's not super effective. And I'm also not very good with it. So, I mean, there's probably things I could do to make myself better with it. But I just don't practice with it enough. And I think that's probably what I need more than anything. But in the end, it got done the way that I wanted. It just took a little bit longer on the scroll saw than I'd expected. This is at 900 speed. So it actually looks like it's going really slow in the clip. But it's not going nearly that slow. I think that's just how the frames worked out. Makes it look like it's going slow. But anyway, we're going to get into a couple other steps here in just a moment. We're going to start getting prepared to do the inlay part of it. Now, we actually put the inlay in at the end. That'll be the last thing we do on the knife, essentially, is put the skulls in the holes that we're going to cut. But right now, we're getting it set up, sanding and some filing. I'll let you listen to that song for just a minute more, and I'll get back to some commentary. Okay, real quick, a couple things that you just saw there. I did make a huge mistake while I was drilling that. As you could see, it busted the wood out. I tried to show you on the camera. I hope you could see that it busted the wood. And what ended up happening and the reason that it happened was that I was using the wrong kind of bit. It was the exact right diameters that I wanted, but it you have to have that stuff clamped super hard, and you have to have a different type of drill press, really, something that won't yank itself down and you know, that's got like a power drive or something. Bad drill bit anyway, so I messed up, but luckily it didn't break the wood away any further than what I was going to route out anyway. So I got lucky, but I did make a mistake, and I think things that I can do better there is probably understand the tools that I'm using just a little bit better. And I should have known that about that drill bit, but it is what it is. I figured it out. And we got it set up, and lucky it's not going to impact us too terribly. So this is my little routing setup. It takes a while to set up here, and I'm still getting the depth done. It's hard to see down there. It's a little bit dark in the shadow, so I'm trying to get a flashlight in there, but there's not much room to stick it in there. But I've got it marked on the edge of the piece, and then I'm going to put it over where the hole is after I get the depth set. See, there we go. We got the depth set. We've got it set up. And now we're going to go. I'm just going to get a little bit more light in there. I'm grabbing another lamp. That helps quite a bit. In fact, better for you to see as well. But I just couldn't get you close enough. I don't think there's much that you could see anyway. But I'm just in there routing it out. You make small passes. And you just go slow. You definitely don't want to pass the mark. And again, I made those marks with an X-Acto knife. And there's a couple other videos on YouTube that you can go check out about router-based inlay. The one that I like is from the Wood Whisperer. If you guys want a link, let me know, and I'll put a link on there to that video. But it was really helpful to me when I was learning how to do that. And basically what you do is you go right up against the edge of your cut that you make with the X-Acto knife. And it makes it a lot easier to see when you've got there because the burrs change just a little bit. And I'm getting really close here, and you can kind of test with your finger to make sure that you've cut across that groove that you've cut with the X-Acto knife. But looks good, and I'm just making sure that I can see it. So I kind of packed it in just a little bit, so I ran the knife back through the groove there a couple times, and it made it a little bit easier to see, especially where you kind of have to crane your eyes around. It's nice to have it super visible, but at this level, none of it's super visible to begin with, so it is what it is. We'll get back into some music, and I'll be back with some more commentary. Okay, so we're getting the holes drilled. Again, setup here is what is difficult. It just takes time to get it set up the right way. And you'll notice what I'm doing is I'm putting the scale on where I want it, clamping it as close to perfect as I possibly can. In fact, it is. It's right up next to it. But you have to clamp it in perfectly. If it's got a gap when you clamp it, then you're going to be drilling holes where it's going to force a gap when you actually put the handle on. So be very careful. And I'm not actually drilling straight through both pieces. I just go straight through the wood, and it hits the metal. It makes a mark, and then I drill the mark, or I drill the wood separately, or the metal separately, and then I clamp the other piece on the bottom side, clamp it together really nice and tight, and then just poke it straight through the holes that are in the tongue of the blade there. And that's a nice little method. Works, and then everything lines up the way that you want. As long as you clamp it correctly, it will line up exactly that way. So kind of a good way to do it. But we're getting pretty close to starting to assemble the handle. So here we go. We're going to get these pins done. Now, what I do for the pins, because we're going to peen these pins with a peen hammer, ball peen hammer, you want them to be cut almost exactly the length. And just proud of either side, about a 16th of an inch, or well, actually more like a 32nd of an inch, but just a little bit. And I kind of round the tips just a little bit. It makes it slide through a lot easier. And if you round them too much, make sure that they're long enough where you can sand a little bit off before you peen them, because you don't want too much material. Otherwise, you run the risk of your pins cracking down this, you know, down the cross section straight down into that hole, and that's a no good scenario. See what I'm doing now? I'm using that ball peen hammer, and you want to pound those pins right in the center. I guess not a theory, but the physics behind it is it forces more material down into the center, thus expanding the pin up against the sides, making it a permanent bond, and it's a friction bond. It's very, very difficult to wrench it off. In fact, I don't think you really can wrench it off. If it's peened correctly, you shouldn't never be able to get that sucker off without just grinding it. You just have to grind it off. That's basically the only way. I guess maybe if you had a tap or something and you pounded through it hard enough, you could probably get it out, but it'd be really tough. The friction holds it in very well. So, but now we're to the gluing part. And I made a mistake here while I was gluing, and it cost me some cosmetic value on this knife. What I did is, you can see those pins are actually popping up through the tong right now. And I cut the video short because I was like, oh man, I made a big mistake. So I shut it off and I tried to figure out how to fix it. But what ended up happening is the brass on that one side doesn't go down all the way because the pins got in the way. I shouldn't have put them through, and I couldn't pound them back out. I was having so much trouble anyway, but I cut off the excess wood material on the bandsaw, and this is the long drawn out process. And I'm going to cut this part of the video short, because shaping is, you just sit here and watch me press this thing up against a sander for the next hour, even at 600% speed. But you sand it and shape it. While you're doing that, make sure, if you're shaping wood and metal together, remember that wood will abrade faster than metal will. So keep the pressure on the metal where there's the transition between the two. Because if you put the pressure on the wood and the metal at the same rate, it will sand the wood down way too fast and way too far. And then you mess up your handle. So make sure you keep the pressure on the metal where that transition is. But now we're just finishing up the wood handle with some oil. We'll get that set up, and then we're going to glue in the pins or the conchos, and that's a done deal. So I hope you guys enjoyed this tutorial. It's actually a fairly simple process. It's more time consuming than anything. But it's fun. I think it's a really fun thing to do. Different things, you know, when you have a chance, try and be creative, try and make something that nobody else is making out in the knife making community. And maybe you'll come up with some great things. I think for this one, the mistake that I made on the handle there, I might see if I can get you a better shot. Actually, what I'll do is I'll put the pictures on my Facebook page so you guys can go see a close-up of the mistake that I made. But even with the mistake, it actually turned out quite nice. And I was really pleased. We're pretty pleased with the way that it works. The stuff I'm putting on right now, it's called Renaissance. It's like a protective thing, and it's actually really good for putting on finely buffed material. It helps keep fingerprints from sticking to it, so it won't look as ugly when people are handling it with fingerprints all over it, because people always put fingerprints on it. But anyway, it looks good. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Thank you for watching. The next video I'm going to be putting up should come up either today or tomorrow as well. It's going to be a tutorial on how to drill semi-precious stone, so do check that out, especially if you're interested in making fantasy weapons. It is a useful thing to know how to do for that stuff, and for knife handles as well. There's a lot of people who put semi-precious stone on knife handles. But thanks again. Catch you guys later.